Okay, guys, welcome to 100 Hours, 100 Stars. Over the course of the next 100 hours, we radio presenters are introducing you to 100 stars from various walks of life. And the idea is to try and donate to the COVID-19 crisis. These medical and health practitioners who are in the front line, who are keeping you and me safe. So whatever you're doing in your community, please continue doing that. We, however, have tied up with the PM CARES Fund. That's the Prime Minister CARES Fund. So on the screen, you'll see a QR code or a link. Scan the QR code, click on the link, a page will open up, choose the amount that you want to donate along with your payment details and hit proceed to contribute. One of the loveliest, most luminous people I know, Shibani Dandekar, is my guest now. What's up, yo?
What's up, Rishika? Thank you so much. What a lovely introduction. Happy to be here. Happy to be passing some time during this never-ending lockdown.
You know, as journalists, as radio presenters, we see one side of Shibani Dandekar. But how are you holding up in this? I mean, being home, locked down for a prolonged period of time.
Well, I mean, this different aspects to this, right? I mean, I am inherently quite a lazy girl. So living kind of at home and being on the couch in my sweats has not been such a huge adjustment for me. I think it's just adjusting to why we are locked down, trying to think about the people out there who don't have the privilege of being, you know, in a place where they are able to be locked down. It's such a strange time, you know, like you feel as though, okay, you've been given this time to just kind of chill and you're not on the go and you're not constantly working and running from one meeting to another or one shoot to another. So you have the luxury of kind of just being at home, and all you really have to do is occupy your time, whether that's learning to play the piano like I'm doing, or whether you're reading a book, or whether you're in a writer's room for a show, which I'm doing at the moment. There's so many different things that I have, like I'm lucky to be able to do. And there's so much talk about how we should use this time and use it to reflect and really use it to do new things and good things, but you just cannot help but think about the people who are not able to use this time as effective time, downtime that they have. They're like literally trying to figure out how they're going to survive from day to day. So those guilty pangs do happen throughout the day when you feel like, my God, I'm learning a new hobby, you know, and I'm getting the time to kind of sleep in. I get to work out twice a day. I'm attempting to cook and I'm terrible at it, but it's just, you can't help but think about the people who don't have, aren't you lucky enough to do this. And that kind of, that makes me feel quite terrible, if I'm honest.
Yeah, I mean, gratitude is something that I've really learned to cultivate in this phase, you know, just gratitude for the small things in life. So, you know, for a show that's so filled with estrogen, so many girls, I don't mean just the cast, I mean even the director and the writer.
The crew.
Season one was also just the crew, everything. I mean, it's fantastic the number of guys who are enjoying this show. Me, for one, I mean, I ran through in the entire season two in like one sitting. It was just of those binge-watching things, you know. And I have to say that, you know, this one makes more sense to me. The first one, I think there was a lot of pressure on them to be risque. I mean, I'm not complaining about all the lovemaking, but there was a lot of risque stuff, which was just there. But now this is more about the relationships, which I think is really cool.
Yeah, yeah.
Is that what drew you to Sushmita and this particular series, the moment, you know, they narrated or send you the bound script?
Yeah, absolutely. Look, I'm a huge Sex and the City fan, right? So we know that this is loosely kind of, you know, a story of four girls based out of Mumbai. And there's a lot of, like, you know, resemblance there, I guess, in a sense. But this is a completely different story, right? And yes, you're right, in the first season, I mean, I'm sure there were a lot of liberties taken in terms of what they wanted to show and how they wanted to show it. But you do go a little bit deeper in season two, and you've got just that, like, story of four women and the substance of their relationships and their lives and the things that they go through. And when I was told about Sushmita's part, number one, it was a really interesting conversation that I had with Rangita, because she was like, listen, there's this part for you, but I feel like it might be a little bit older than you know, what you're expecting. And I was like, well, how old is this character? And she was like, she's 41. And I was like, Rangita, I'm 40. it's okay. I'm okay to do it. You know, so it was instantly something that I loved. I kind of thought that this Sushmita is somebody who we see so often, you know, this like power broker who is in a relationship of convenience of sorts. And she's somebody who is trying to show face and has this mask on to the world about what her real love life is actually like. You know, so often we kind of like put things aside, brush things under the carpet and go out and face the world as if everything is okay, you know, because that's just what is expected. So there was a lot of that to Sushmita. And obviously you realize that during this showdown that she has, that she's actually just human and that she feels and that she's going through a lot of stuff. So it was a really interesting character for me, and it's something that I've never been able to play before. And I think one of the main things is I've always been given these like NRI friend roles that have never really amounted to anything. You know what I mean? It's like blink and miss and Shibs is gone. And for the first time, this wasn't that. So it was an opportunity for me to also actually do something. So that's why when I spoke to Nupur and Shubham and Trishan, who cast me for this, and also Rongita, I was really grateful for the opportunity to be able to do something. Because I think that's really important as an actor. You want to just not be cast just based on looking a certain part, right? I mean, if I've been hired as an NRI for something, it's because I'm an NRI and because I would be good as playing the friend. But then there needs to be some sort of substance to it, something that you can actually do with it. So I feel like for the first time, I was given something, not very many scenes, but still something to do.
Yeah, and you know, in that aspect, I do want to talk about this. It's not a spoiler because the multitudes have seen it. It's been out for a week plus now.
Yeah,
There's a confrontation scene and you're just absolutely stellar in it. I mean, just the fact that you went about the business in a confrontation scene, I mean, it's not a spoiler anymore. Like I said, you're a victim of being cheated upon, you know?
Yeah.
And how Sushmita, the character, reacts to that. And that's something which is, you know, is hurtful for anybody, man or woman, you know, to be the victim of that in a relationship. So that really is, you know, your coup de resistance in the whole series. So talk to me about that. The relationship between Sushmita and her lawyer husband and, you know, what it all comes down to.
I think it's just a point where Sushmita kind of, you know, I've been in situations like this before where you kind of know you're in a relationship and you know something is kind of going, but you choose to maybe look the other way or maybe convince yourself that it's not going on. And then when it kind of all comes to, you know, breaking point and reaches a place where you just can't ignore it anymore. And that moment where Sushmita walks in and she sees it firsthand, it's like everything that you have, like all this pent up, built up stuff that you've been bottling, it just kind of unleashes. And for me, my approach to that was more just letting it happen, you know, because I knew the dialogue was there. I knew that I had a base to work off. But it was really more about just what you feel in that moment. Because these kinds of things, when you're fighting with somebody, you feed off so much of what they're saying and how they're saying it and what their reaction is. So it was actually really funny because Sam and I are so used to doing the whole, hello and welcome to extra innings and match 64. And, you know, so for us to be standing there and having this massive argument was a complete 180 for the two of us. But we didn't talk about it beforehand. We didn't rehearse it. We just kind of went with it. And as the scene starts, I kind of enter the room. So the minute I enter the room, Sam and I just kind of went for it. And at the end of the scene, I'm supposed to just kind of exit. So when I exited the first time, there was just silence on the set. And I just, because I'm also just so new at this, you know, I thought, oh, Jesus, I'd like, fucked up royally, you know. Was it not good? Is it just silence? This silence is not good. And as it turns out, it had quite an impact even on, you know, the people that were watching there in person. And it's so funny how when you are standing with someone that you have known for years and having this like massive blowout argument where you are, yes, you're sticking to the script, but then you're also like, there's so much impromptu stuff happening. And it's like your history with each other goes flying out the window. Suddenly you're standing there and you are Shashank and Sushmita. And I think that so many of us women, and men as well, have been through this moment. You know, it's just that a lot of the times you have this moment in private behind closed doors. So to be able to just unleash this frustration that Sushmita had was a really nice moment for me to kind of live. I know that sounds weird, but it was.
Yeah. And you know, I have so many powerful women friends who've achieved a certain amount of success in their corporate lifestyle. They're in the law and this and that. But at the end of the day, in relationships, they're just, you know, they could be teenage or adolescent girls, you know, who just want to come back to their man, to wherever they are, and just feed off that honesty. And, you know, and at that point, you really feel that maybe all Sushmita wants is honesty in a relationship. And the deceit of it is what really gets to her. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that there are sometimes so many things said in relationships that are kind of unspoken. So did Shashank and Sushmita have an open relationship? Was he being honest about that? Did she actually know that in words? Was it a discussion? Or was it something that was kind of just assumed between the two of them? But then when it comes to the forefront, how somebody reacts to that when they know that, okay, now he is actually living this open relationship. You know, when that hits home, it's painful. Look, as strong as we are, and as much of a front as we put on, and as brave as we can be, working hard, like powerful at the companies that we work at, still human beings. We still feel the things that we feel, and women go through these emotions all the time. You know, it doesn't matter what walk of life you're from. And it's not just women, it's men as well. But in a relationship, these are such delicate things to handle, because these days there are so many different types of relationships. You know, everyone is making their own rules. There are different formulas. So in our case with Shashank and Sushma, obviously it wasn't as rosy as what they were trying to portray. But I think Sushmita realized that there were so many things just kind of falling apart in that moment.
So I know that Sam and you know each other from before, because you've been colleagues, you worked before. Was it Udaipur that you were filming?
It was Udaipur.
How are the girls? I mean, who did you get along with in that set? They're also such diverse characters.
Yeah, and you know when you walk onto a set after a season of this already happening, you kind of feel like, oh God, you're like the newcomer.
Those bonds are established. You
know, yeah, established, and not just established on the show, but established in the business, you know, and this is relatively new for me. So, but they were just, honestly, they were just so lovely. And you know, there are so many things said about so many women on one set and how kind of intimidating that can be, but everybody was just really warm and lovely. Mandy and I probably got along the best, like house on fire. I remember her coming to my room and chatting with me about scenes. Shayani and I, the same. She also came and spoke to me about scenes. So it was really nice. It just felt like, because we were all in the same hotel for a week, we kind of just hung out quite a bit, even after we finished shooting. Obviously Sam and I know each other from before. Kirti, I just actually met. We'd never met before. So it was really lovely to meet her. She's such an awesome person. And Bani and I had done I Can Do That together, a reality show, a couple of years ago. So we already knew each other from that. Lisa, I also just met. It was actually just so lovely, you know, to be in such a supportive, lovely environment. And everyone was just really into what they were doing and into the characters and into just getting it to be as good as it can be. It was just really fun. We faced some issues with rain during the one wedding scene where we had to do outdoors. There was like downpour. Then Nupur, the director, hurt her ankle. So she was being pushed around in a wheelchair while there was rain. It was quite eventful, but it was a lot of fun. It was a lot of fun. I'd love to do it again.
So just some trivia. I don't know. You didn't grow up in India, but Nupur used to direct the show. We all grew up to that gig. It was called Hip Hip Hooray. And, you know, it was quite a cult show at the time. It was a show about, you know, high school and school, much before Student of the Year and what Karan was doing and things like that. So your experience of working with Nupur, I mean, she just disappeared for the longest time and she's come back.
She was fabulous. She was actually there we first met the day, so I did the audition for Sushmita, and then when they called me back, Nupur wanted to kind of just go run through a scene. I met her there for the first time. We had finished doing the scene, and I was kind of quiet at that point, except when I was doing the scene. I didn't, you know, you don't want to like walk into a casting office and be all like, oh my God, hi. So you just kind of do your bit and but as I was leaving, she started cheering and I heard. So I turned around and she kept quiet. So I thought, oh, maybe I've got it. I don't know. So that was my first experience. That was my kind of first experience with her, but she was amazing. She let me really go for it. You know, she spoke to me about the scene, but especially with that confrontation scene, she just let me go for it. She just said, you just do what you're feeling, and then let's go from there. And that really worked. The scene where we kind of, where Kirti and I speak after that, where Anjana and I speak after that, she was beautiful during that scene because she knew exactly where to kind of let me go, pull me in a little bit, just, you know, because the subtlety, the nuances are really needed in that scene. And she kind of really guided me. And also, let's just keep in mind that, you know, it is someone who's, Hindi is not my first language, right? Sure. So there's so much to also focus on. So when you have a director who kind of gets that and is looking out for all these different things, really empowers you. It makes you, I'm one of those people who responds to that. Like, I feel like if someone was to like give me a hard time on set and tell me off, I'd kind of freak out a little bit, but she knew exactly how to kind of guide me through it, which was great.
So how are you handling all the essentials and the groceries? Do you do runs twice a week, go out and get them in? Or do you have somebody delivering it downstairs in the building or the house and you go up and bring up the supplies and sanitize it? So how's that happening?
We have like everything that is needed to make sure that everything is properly sanitized. It's left outside the house, sanitized, then comes into the house. Grocery runs generally happen once or twice a week. We go to Bali Market and food hall, gloves, mask, shower as soon as we get home. We're just trying to, I mean, you know, we've tried to like be as mindful as we can in terms of, you want to stock up, but not stock up to the point where you don't leave anything for anybody else, but you stock up enough so that you don't have to make regular trips so that not everybody is also out at the same time. So stock up on the things that you can, but not in a crazy way. So, you know, that's also been a learning process. I tried to be mindful of that. We've kind of fallen into a rhythm as to how that works. Yeah.
Yeah. And
I also got a new puppy.
Yeah. I saw some pictures. So the earlier one is Tyson, isn't it?
No, the earlier one is Jimmy.
Jimmy. Okay. And this one's
Tyson. And the new one is Tyson. Yeah. She was, Tyson is a girl, although we've given her the name Tyson, which confuses the hell out of everyone, which I love. We found her at GTC, which is a place where, Farhan was shooting and training for Tufan. They have like a boxing setup over there. So there were a bunch of like stray, puppies and dogs, stray dogs actually. And they had a huge litter. And one by one, people started taking a pup from the new litter, which is great. And there were three little girls left. And for 3 days, just before the lockdown, we were going there to train. And every day I kept saying to him, we've got to take one. And on the last day, believe it or not, a day or two before the lockdown, as he was walking out, I said to him, can we please? And he was like, if you're going to do it, you need to pick her up right now. Because it's one of those things that you have to just make that decision. You can't like, you know, prolong the decision. So we just kind of picked her up and we took her home just 2 days before the lockdown. So she's just been driving us mental for the entire time we've been at home. I can hear her crying out. So, yeah.
And you're braving the whole kitchen routine. I mean, I noticed that you were on the phone with Kelvin. Oh, I miss his food. Anyway, so
I know.
And getting some baking done and getting some cooking done. So good. You know, you're using it to add to your skill set, as it were. Awesome.
I am. And I think that Sunita, you know, who lives here with us, she is the best because she's so supportive, although she knows that I cannot cook for shit. She is the only one who will eat my cookies and be like, I love them. I think they're great. But look, you can be friends with all the chefs you want. Kelvin is like one of my closest friends, but even he cannot help me. I've tried and I will continue to try, but it's just one of those things. I feel like you have the skill or you don't. I get really flustered in the kitchen. It's a real, you know, once the gas comes on and there's a million, the garlic is burning and there's just so much happening. It's nothing but respect to people who can cook, really. So I'm an eater. I eat food.
There are the eaters and the cookers.
Exactly.
I know which side I am. I'm glad you're on that side. So how are the folks and the sisters doing? You know, I always worry for senior citizens. My parents used to work in Mumbai. They retired and they moved down south. And, you know, you're always worried saying, you know, how are they getting their supplies? Are they healthy and things like that? So are the video calls happening with the folks, you know, with the sisters, just keeping in touch? Yeah.
Yeah, they are. We video call quite often, and it's crazy because this time has really allowed you to stay in touch with people better. Mum and Dad were supposed to fly back to Australia actually the week that this happened and couldn't get flights out, which I feel in a way is a blessing because at least they're in the same time zone. You know, they're in Pune, but at least, you know, we can kind of speak and check in on them. Mum is doing, I think, grocery runs once a week. But yeah, apart from that, sisters are good. My sister's at home. She's got her two dogs. And then my other sister is with her husband and her dog. So we check in on each other quite a bit.
What's the first thing you're going to do when the lockdown is lifted? I mean, instinctively, what is that first thing?
I mean, you'd want to just see people that you've missed, you know? I don't know if we'll be able to hug them, but I miss my friends, you know? I miss Dino. I miss Monica. My two best friends who I used to see all the time, like I haven't seen forever, only via like video chat. So I think it's about, I don't know. I think there are just so many changes that you kind of want to make. Just being mindful of so many things. I know that this sounds all preachy, but I think it's true. Like, I think we've got to start being a little bit, do you think we will though? Do you think we will start being smarter about things, or will we just fall back into old patterns? I don't know.
You know, I start with pessimism and I say, you know, history shows that we fall back into patterns, but I don't even want to start, continue thinking that way. I'm like, I won't even break my own pessimism now. So
I hear you. I hear you. Like, it just gives you time to put things into perspective and really think about the things that you can do, even if they're like the smallest things, right? Even if they're as just things where you are maybe talking. I mean, Dia talks so much about this, not just during the lockdown, but she spends so much of her time talking about looking after the planet and not using plastic and, you know, just things that I feel like we can do to make changes, to kind of just make things better. It's almost like the planet has just moved us right out of the way to just heal for a bit before it can take on our crap again. You know what I mean?
So the piano classes are what? Do you take them online? Do you have a tutor or are you just doing a YouTube kind of lesson? What are you doing?
Yeah, just doing YouTube lessons. So I'm just kind of picking songs that I like to sing and then learning them. And the thing is, when I was learning piano when I was a kid, it was like you had to go to somebody's house who had a piano who would then teach you the notes and the read sheet music. And it was so old school. These days, you download the app and you go onto YouTube and they just teach you the song and you just sing along. So it's like a song a day that you're learning, you know? I love it. It's great. So then Farhan plays the guitar, I play the piano, and we kind of great to take this band on the road.
So I understand that, you know, you're in writer's room, you're writing and things like that. Are you in a position to tell us what that's for, or you want to keep it under wraps, or are you working on
What I will tell you is that I am working with my partners, Gaurav Kapoor and Akanksha Seda, on a web show. We are just in the process of getting that written at the moment. So we're in the writer's room. We have been for the last month and a half. Obviously can't say what it's about, but we're really excited about it. So hopefully by the end of the lockdown, the Bible should be ready and we're to go.
And if not anything else, Kapoor must be keeping you entertained. He's such an entertainer.
Oh, yeah. he's amazing, you know? I mean, our relationship has just grown so much since we started doing the IPL, and now we're partners on this, and it's just been such a absolutely crazy ride. But yeah, he's just hilarious. Between him and Cyrus and Sammy Kocha, I'm just like surrounded by like 20 dudes.
Funny dudes, yeah. Okay, guys, 100 hours, 100 stars is you meeting these wonderful people over the next 100 hours. Just a final reminder, there's a QR code as well as a link on the screen. Scan the QR code, click on the link, feed in payment details. This goes to our COVID warriors, our medical and health practitioners who are fighting for us in the front lines. It will go to the PM CARES Fund, the Prime Minister CARES Fund. Shibani Dandekar, thank you for your time.
Thank you so much, Rishi K. Always an absolute pleasure. And I'm sending you a big, fat virtual hug.
Virtual hug. Cheers.
Hoping to see you really soon. Yes. Lots of love. Lots Bye. Of.
Power of three. Number one station in Delhi, Mumbai, Bangalore, and Kolkata. Fever FM, the bomb of Bollywood.
Congratulations to all of you for being the number one radio station.
The biggest CSR initiative on radio. Pioneers of radio drama in the industry. Sports tie-ups, official radio partners of five winning IPL teams. Most entertaining shows and RJs. Nasha, India's coolest retro station. 107.2 Radio Nasha. Nasha, 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 Nasha. Gaane ka Nasha, gungunane ka Nasha, sunne ka Nasha, suna. Celebrities. Best of Retro. Shows and RJs that take you back in time. Radio One, India's only international network. The only radio station Katy Perry vibed with. We were there when U2 performed for the first time in India. Global teen sensation Justin Bieber jams with Radio 1. truly global shows and RJs. Mega Mix, America's Top 40, The Mahindra Blues Show, and more.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, fans of Fever FM 94.3, Radio 1 and Radio Nasha. A very warm welcome to 100 Hours, 100 Stars. And we have one of our stars here with us, Somdev Devvarman, ex-tennis star and multiple award winners. And of course, right now, an amazing fitness motivation icon. And in addition to that, he also does a lot of philanthropy. So a very warm welcome, Somdev.
Thanks a lot, Vikram. Thanks for having me on the show.
It's always a pleasure to have you. And I think I'm going to just continue the conversation from the last time we spoke. I think every time you've told me about, you've come on the show, we've spoken a little about Life is a Ball and Wild Warrior Races. So I'm going to start with, Life is a Ball again. So one of the first things that I realized when I realized that I'm going to talk to you this time was that when you told me about Life is a Ball the first time, I did not question you about why you chose football over other sports, because I love football. So the minute you said football, I was very happy to hear that. But why did you pick football over other sports?
I mean, to be honest with you, it's just the functionality of it. You know, all you require for football is one ball. If you have a little bit of space, that's pretty much all you required. And so it obviously kind of put our costs down as well.
Okay.
Because, you know, to have something like a tennis court, it's a lot more complicated than just having, football. So I think that was probably the initial reason. And also, I mean, it's the most commonly played sport in the world.
In the world, yes.
Right. You know, so when we were kind of dealing with these issues, we just figured that football would be the best place to start. And then if we grew from there, that would be a nice thing as well.
All right. Actually, for the sake of people who are just hearing about Life is a Ball for the first time, why don't you give us a quick idea of what Life is a Ball is about?
Okay, so Life is a Ball is a charity that I formed with a couple of my friends that I grew up with in 2011. And essentially what we do is we take sports to, you know, underprivileged communities and schools, and we just provide organized sports and give these kids a chance to play sport and grow through sport. And we do it in school, after school. And the point is, just to get people playing sport, get interested. And, you know, through that journey itself, a lot of good things will happen. So that's really what Life is a Ball is all about. And we're all about promoting sport.
Okay, actually, how many cities are you guys present in Life is a Ball?
So over the course of, close to 10 years now, 9 years or so, we've worked in probably about 10 or 12 cities, but as of right now, we work in 3 cities, Hyderabad, Mumbai, and Chennai.
Okay. So now that, 100 Hours, 100 Stars is a nationally, national coverage-oriented, event, I would say, when it comes to digital media. I wanted to know, if there is a person from, let's say, a tier 2 city or a city in which you guys haven't set foot in, and if he wants to associate with Life as a Ball, is that actually possible?
Absolutely, it's possible. See, so the way we look at it, we want to be a very sustainable program. So one of the most important things for all of us at Life as a Ball is once you begin working with a program, you at least have a 5-year goal. And you commit to kind of working with those children for 5 years at least. Ideally, it would be longer, but, sometimes it's not that easy. So I think if somebody is out there who's willing to commit 5 years to a program, I think then it's a great place for us to start.
Okay, so where does he begin? How does he start?
Start by reaching out to me. Life is a Ball. You can find our information online. You can find you can follow what we do on Instagram, and just kind of get in touch, begin a conversation. And obviously, there's a lot of things to iron out. I don't think it's that simple. We gotta take into consideration, what target group of kids we're going for. Is it a school? Is it a community? What sports do you want to do? How do you want to do it? What's the current status of things in that community? For example, is it a community that's affected by crime? Mm-hmm. Is it a community that people don't study? Or, is it a school? So you've got to kind of obviously address a few of those issues. And every city has its own challenges.
Okay.
So once we kind of pick a place, then we see what kind of surrounding it is, and that's when we kind of progress to deciding how we want to put our program into that city.
And you guys would like obviously guide him and help him through this process, right?
Yeah, absolutely, because we've obviously done it in the past. In all the states that we work in, we always get a no objection certificate from the education department, so it's kind of easier for us to go in. So we partner with the schools in a sense, and we partner with the state education boards as well. And that's something we would always want to do, because at the end of the day, if the push comes from the highest place, it's always a lot easier to move the conversation forward.
There's actually another thing that I wanted to ask you about, Soma. There is, different people are contributing to different charities. Like right now, we have QR codes around the screen. But you guys, as tennis stars, you've gotten together and you've started a charity of your own. Could you tell us something more about that?
So the initiative is called Love All, and we're doing it through my charity, which has been established for almost 10 years now. And the initial feeling was, we got a couple phone calls through friends in the tennis community, and we were discussing how, many people, the Markers, the Ball Kids, really the heart and soul of tennis academies or clubs, anywhere you go to, they've really been hit hard and they're really struggling through this time. And for anyone who spent time, around these places, around tennis courts, around clubs, you know what an important part they play in kind of making sure that everything is okay. So, we felt like it was our responsibility to come together. So, I spoke to Sanya, I spoke to Mahesh, Leander, pretty much all the other, anybody in the tennis community in India, to kind of, come together in an effort to reach out to a bunch of people, raise some funds, and give it all back to those who are really struggling right now. So it's our small effort of doing that, and hopefully we can make a difference in these people's lives.
Very nice. So is this going to, do you have like a time frame? Are you going to close it at some date, or is it going to go on all the way till COVID or Corona is around? How have you guys decided that?
Well, I think it's going to be it's a little bit situational, because we don't really know what to expect. We know that potentially it's May 3rd, but we don't know that either. And more importantly, we don't really know when academies can open up. We don't know when tournaments can happen. We don't know when the next sporting event's going to happen. So there's a lot of stuff up in the air, which the uncertainty is what's kind of making people nervous as well. Obviously, ideally, we would like everything to start back up. But since we have no control over that, one of the things we would want to do is continue raising funds as long as we can, and continue helping as much as we can, as many people as we can during this time. And I think if we do that to the best of our abilities, we'll be playing our part.
All right. Okay, so now getting to a little bit of a personal question. So you're a married man now. So how's marriage life treating you?
Unbelievable. Should have done it earlier. we've been married for a little over a year now. And luckily for me, we were dating for about 5 years as well before that. So, it was a nice little progression. And I think when we did get married, I was very ready. And so was she. We were very ready to get married and move in and start our lives together. So, I would highly recommend it to all of my friends who are on the fence.
Okay, so on the corona front, I've been here. I mean, we've been reading articles everywhere that, domestic violence, domestic abuse has gone up. So has she started beating you up yet?
I mean, we've had our fair share of fights, but there's not been any beating. And I think the fair share of fights is normal. I could be living in here with my brother or my mom or anybody. And I think, 40, 50, 60 days in isolation with a person, it's normal to have a few arguments. But one of my friends told me this just the other day. We were discussing this, and he said, I think fights are normal. Fights are healthy. As long as your fights are like a 6 out of 10, then you're completely good to go. And like, as long as they're not 10 out of 10 too often, I think you're good. And I think I think there's some wisdom to that.
Very nice. Okay, I think that is some wisdom that everybody can take a little of. But yes, besides that, on the corona front, in the quarantine time, how have you guys been dealing with the quarantine? What do you guys do at home? What is the scenario like?
Honestly, the first week or 10 days was vacation. From home, which is what it's felt like even now. It's been over a month, and then after about the first 10 days, both of us wanted to get productive with our time. We both wanted to kind of do things. So I started playing a lot more music. I started doing a lot more live stuff. I started kind of started this stuff with Life is a Ball. Actually, we started fundraising for markers and nice. People all around India who really required help. So, and my wife's kind of taken a lead on that as well. So she's been helping with the foundation stuff. Music for me, painting for her, and a little bit of interviews. Nice. And, I'm trying to keep the tennis conversation going. So honestly, I feel like I'm pretty busy, but at the same time, I feel like I'm home and I feel like I'm doing things that I really enjoy. So, barring the terrible stuff that's happening, we're trying to keep ourselves in the best frame of mind possible.
Nice. Actually, you know what? I don't know if you heard of this Tamil film called Arunachalam. Have you? It's a Rajni film.
I have not.
No? Okay, so in the film, Rajni's dad kind of catches him smoking one day. So the solution to that is he puts him in a room filled with cigarettes and cigars and makes him smoke the entire thing, and only then he can get out of the room. And by the time he comes out, he's so done with it. He's so done with tobacco, and he's like, no, I'm not going to smoke ever again. So similarly, that's kind of what this quarantine has done to us. It's given us all the time that we need to be lazy. So once you're done with all of it, once you're done with all the working, all the time that you spend frivolously, and then you actually say, okay, where is work? Can I work now? Can somebody give me some work? So I think all of us have gone through that phase in this period.
Yeah, I mean, listen, either it's that, I mean, that does make sense. Either it's that, or all of us at the end of the day are just never going to be happy with what we have. So if we have time at home, we're not happy. If we have to go to work, we're not happy. If we have to grind, so regardless, so I mean, there's so many different ways of looking at it. But the cool thing about this is, like, I feel like we're having very different conversations with our friends.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like I've had, like, the friends that I've actually reconnected with, I mean, it's been really cool because, you know, we get together, we have, you know, social drinks at home, or, you know, we kind of catch up at home and things like that. And the world has never been through something like this. You know, so the stuff that's coming out is actually pretty cool.
That's nice. Okay, actually, on that front, staying at home and dealing with your fitness part of it, how are you doing that?
Lucky, man. Very lucky, because we have a terrace at home.
Ooh.
And since, the terrace is fairly unused, mm-hmm. and in our building, there's a couple of our friends who live here.
Oh, okay.
So that makes it a lot easier. And we had a little gym, but the gym was in a tiny room, so we moved everything to the terrace. And so, you know, we've been really lucky. We have a jump rope. We have pretty much everything you need in terms of fitness. So, it is funny because, like, that's something that, like, all of us are looking forward to every single day. Even if you're not working out, you just want to go and hang out upstairs, get some fresh air. And the funny thing is, when you go to the terrace, you realize everybody else who has a terrace is doing the exact same thing. You know, at least everyone around our house. So it's pretty cool. I'll be the first one to admit, I know my neighbors much better now than I did last 1 year.
That's true. You know, actually, it's been a really long time since I saw a carom board. I think it was back in school the last time I played. And then suddenly the other day I go to the terrace and one of my neighbors has brought his board to the terrace and all the kids are sitting around there playing. And I'm like, oh my God, this is what the quarantine's done to people. That's nice.
It is nice. On the bright side, the med stores are open, so you can get some boric powder.
Okay, and on the other hand, talking about fitness, going a step further, Wild Warrior races, how is that going?
It's tough right now. It's mm-hmm. really, really tough. I mean, we are online, we are having a conversation, and we make sure we are in touch with a lot of athletes. I think there's a lot of live sessions going on Insta and things like that. But in terms of the event, I think any space that has events has been hit very badly. Live events, because of, you know, you can't have any event where people are going to gather, right? So it's a little early to speculate right now, but, you know, it seems to me that at least live sporting events with a bunch of people, it's going to take a little time before that's normal. You know, so we just have to wait and see kind of what happens, what the regulations are. It's too early to tell, but, you know, we'll have to see.
Very nice. Okay, and actually one part that I missed out when I was talking about you staying at home. How is it going in the self-reflection flame?
It's going, man. It's going. You can't hide it. I don't care who you are. You can't hide it. It's, I mean, it's I think necessary as well. You know, I'm 35 years old, and I'll be the first one to say that there's still a lot more to get out of this. You know,
I know, right?
Yeah, that's the scary part. You know, so
I mean, until the quarantine and until Corona hit, I'm thinking, okay, you know what? Well, I've hit 30, after it's all downhill, and then suddenly you think about how short a time you have now, and you're like, oh my God, I have so much to do.
I know, you have so much, exactly, and like, and also clarity, right? You have to, like, you can't,
priorities.
Yeah, you can't lie to yourself, you can't hide from yourself, you can't hide from how you're feeling, or what you feel about certain things, or, you know, so it's, I mean, listen, I'm also, it's fun to be introspective sometimes, you know, and I think this is a good time. It's a, I mean, better time than any other to kind of, you know, go in that direction.
I know, especially since you're spending so much time with yourself. I think it your mind brings you back to that question over and over again. And I think it's a good thing, right?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. And in terms of, I mean, on the show, I have this segment called Quarantine Diaries. So where people, you know, every day they tell me things that they're doing to keep themselves engaged when they have free time at home. So I've heard things all the way from I'm sorting out my music library to I'm getting the neighbors' kids together and playing a game with them to all sorts of things. In fact, one person listened to the show. I asked them to go donate blood and she actually went and donated blood for someone, you know. So that was a really nice thing. I was really happy to hear that. So something like that. What are you up to? What are you doing in your free time at home? Something new that you haven't been doing in a while?
Cleaning. I mean, I've cleaned my desk like 5 times over, and I've organized. I mean, go to my clothes shelf right now. And I'm not saying I've done it alone. A lot of it was influenced by my wife. But yeah, it's happened. A lot of organization and cleaning, and my T-shirts and everything is in order now. And yeah, just things like that, man. It's, you know, a lot of things. A lot of. I think for me, it's just organization.
Okay. In fact, it's been a while since I visited your place. So I'm actually wondering how you know, it used to be a perfect man cave back then. And I wonder how much of an influence your wife has had on the house right now.
Well, for starters, there's a lot of flowers.
I saw that.
There's a lot of flowers, and there's a lot more plants than I've ever had. And the plants that I do have are doing well compared to the ones that I had when I was a bachelor. It feels horrible to joke about, but it's true. And it's just neater. It's nicer. It's nice to wake up to.
It feels like home. It feels like home.
Yeah, and there's always fresh food. I think that's the biggest difference. There's always fresh food in the house. So and it's not acceptable to have dirty dishes. It's not acceptable. Yeah.
Nice. So the actual traits are coming out. You know, I can actually see the dirty dishes. That is one thing that people mostly don't think about when they think about bachelor houses. I don't want to talk about my house, so yeah.
Let's move on. I'm going to avoid that one, bro.
But bringing you back to tennis, is there a player right now, a young player coming up right now, that you wish was around when, you know, you were playing, or at least in your younger days?
You mean from India or globally?
Anywhere.
For sure. I mean, dude, the excitement in global tennis is huge. I think, you know, a lot of guys that are coming on the block, Medvedev and Tsitsipas and all of these guys, I feel like the next gen is breaking through. But also in India, probably the most promising Indian player is Sumit Nagal.
Mm-hmm.
22 years old. Last year, he took a set of Roger at the US Open. So I think, the tennis conversation in India, I think, is going to revolve around Sumit and probably Ram Kumar.
Nice.
Rajesh has been doing well as well. So the singles conversation will revolve around these guys for at least the next couple of years.
Nice. Very nice. Actually, now I have a few, quick fire questions for you. I wouldn't give you too much time to think on them. But very simple question. Very, very simple question. Yeah. The first question, I'm going to start really, really light on this. Yeah. Which is your favorite app? One app that you would suggest to people that is not like one of those mainstream apps, not like in Facebook or an Instagram. Something that you think that, oh, this is one app that I love.
Oh, wow. One app that I love. I mean, not a Twitter, right? So, a running app.
Oh, which one?
I used to use Strava.
Okay.
Yeah, I used to use that one because just kind of wherever you run it, make sure, or bike. I used to bike a lot around the city. I think you remember that. So this is when I actually picked up the app. I biked for probably like 6 months around the city, and I had no clue how much I biked. And so the following year, I used it and I found out I biked close to 3,000 kilometers in one year. It's not that much.
I basically
stopped using my car.
250 kilometers a month.
Give or take, somewhere around there. So Strava helped a lot with that and biking and running.
To be honest, that's still about 100 times more than what I do on a monthly basis. So, yeah, that's awesome. I only pull out my cycle to go to the shop nearby, which is like 200 meters away. So, yeah. All right. So, one offbeat musician that you would like to suggest to people watching?
One offbeat musician?
Yeah.
A tallest man on earth.
Uh-huh. Where's he from? Any idea?
He's Swedish.
Okay.
He's Swedish singer-songwriter, written beautiful songs. Kind of sounds like an oldish Bob Dylan kind of thing.
Nice.
But he's like a young guy and he comes up with some beautiful songs. Great guitar player as well. Super
awesome.
Lyrics. And yeah, check him out for sure. Tallest man on earth.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And this is again very, very simple. A film that you think everybody should watch. That you would tell make people watch. Not even tell people.
Good Will Hunting.
Oh, nice! Give me a watch on five.
Easy. I actually have a piece on my right above my desk that's a quote from Good Will Hunting. So yeah.
Nice. Okay. So this next one is again very simple. Netflix or Prime?
Netflix.
Okay. So this is next.
Wait till I come up with a show and it goes on Prime. For now, it's Netflix.
Or even Hotstar for that matter. It'll be the best one then.
Yeah.
Okay, so the next one is very tricky. Yeah, you got to, consider your options really well. Yeah. And I'm asking this knowing that you're a football fan and knowing your priorities. Okay. United or Chelsea?
Oh, do you really have to ask me these kind of questions? Come on, it's Man United all the way. Glory, glory.
I really had to bring that up. Okay, so now coming to food. I mean, you love food. You've spoken so much about food on the show before. But when it comes to, cuisine, would you go with South Indian since you've been here so long? Or is it still North Indian? Or would you go back to Assamese food? Or is it international cuisine?
Breakfast South Indian for sure. That's easy. Good story, my wife's favorite place for me to take her, our go-to place is Murugan Idli.
Ooh, okay. Yeah.
So we used to, there's a bunch of them pretty close to our house. And so we go there for dates all the time.
Ooh, nice.
Yeah.
Dates and Murugan Idli. Very nice. Very interesting. Yeah. I'm pretty sure a lot of people will be surprised with this. Is the dosa Akkas, the auntie Akkas still there near your place? You've spoken about her once before.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Dosa and pongal.
Ah, yeah.
She was a lady who lived under very close to my house. We used to just walk over and get. I know all of these people through my bachelor days. I wasn't looking anything. I used to wake up hungry and walk around. Especially when I first moved back to Chennai about 5-6 years ago. Yeah, but she should be around. But during the lockdown, we haven't checked.
Not right now. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, and so this is one thing I wanted to ask. I mean, I've been talking about this to a lot of people because there's too much hype around this particular thing, and that makes me not indulge in it. What do you think of Money Heist?
My wife watches it a lot. Okay. I don't know. I don't know how I feel about it. I'm okay. I've seen it, so I know the name Tokyo and Denver and Copenhagen or something like that. Yeah. And the professor and Sergio, I think his name is.
I have no idea. I haven't watched the show. I haven't watched a single episode.
Dude, it has to live up to the hype. There are a lot too many people like it.
All right. So now getting to my agenda for this, this hour is Somdev's music. I've been hearing a lot about it lately. In fact, the newspapers have started speaking about it. So would you sing for us, play for us?
Well, should I sing a song that I wrote, or should I sing songs that?
Yeah, I want to hear those.
You wanna? I mean, I did write one about being stuck at in an apocalypse, although this is not an apocalypse. I wrote it as a joke almost.
It's not the end of the world, ladies and gentlemen. It's not.
It is not the end of the world, just to be clear. But at the same time, I kind of wrote a song like that. Should I play some? I have put it out on Instagram as well, but should I play that here?
Yes, please.
So this is songs called If I Was Stuck in an Apocalypse. Mm-hmm. Here we go. I gotta see if I can remember it. Because if I forget the words of my own song, sometimes. Alright, here we go. If I was stuck in an apocalypse, what would I do? Would I hide in a corner? Would I stand my ground? Would I really choose? If I was stuck an apocalypse, how would I be? Would those little things still bother me? Or would they all be free? Oh, I'll tell you what I'm seeking to know. Will the people come together? Will they go above and beyond till our troubles are gone? But only till our troubles are gone. If I was stuck in an apocalypse, what would I eat? Would I still be a vegan if I couldn't find anything but me? If I was stuck in an apocalypse, would I really save? Would those many that up to the dreams I had, would they all be wasted? Oh, I'll tell you what I'm seeking to know. Will the people come together? Will they go above and beyond till our troubles are gone? But only till our troubles are gone.
You know, why I'm thinking at some point I wanted to join, you know, give my own little addition to it, but I was really scared the lag would like ruin the song. So I just let it be.
There is a lag. There is definitely the tiniest bit of lag, but yeah, man, thanks a lot, man. That was fun.
But to be fair, when you said what would I eat, I couldn't stop thinking about the Maggi, the pathetic biryani I make, the pathetic sambar I make.
Yeah, man. You know, that's the other thing. This time has kind of brought me. So when I was a student in college, when I had like literally, I had very little money, I lived off ramen noodles in the States. Like, I used to buy these like big old boxes of like ramen and just stock them up. And just any time in the middle of the day or night, you know that there's food at home, you know? So it's and now I'm doing the same thing. Sometimes I'm bored, but I don't want to make something, and yeah.
Nice. Okay. Actually, there is one other question. It's not a loaded political question. It's a mere fun inquiry, if I should say that. When I was in the Northeast, I was there for about a week, 10 days, and I noticed one thing. Almost all the other states hate Assam. Why is that? What did you guys do to the rest of the states?
I don't know, dude. First of all, I'm from Tripura. I was born. I was born in Assam.
Okay.
Spent a lot of time there as a kid. But I'm from Tripura. Dad's from Tripura. Mom's from Meghalaya. So I don't know. I don't know that. I mean, dude, there's animosity everywhere, man. I don't know. You know. I feel like. But the funny thing about this is. There's animosity while you're within India, but as a person who's lived outside India, like, you know, the north, the people from the north and south, there's nothing there. You know, everyone's happy. They're like, oh my God, you're Indian. And then when you come back here, you fight. So I've always found that funny, but yeah, I feel like that's how it is.
All right. Very nice. Thank you so much, Som. It was great talking to you, connecting. And hopefully, once all of this is over, we'll meet in the studio and have like a normal conversation.
Absolutely, Vikram. Thanks a lot, man.
Thank you so much. Have a great day.